Welcome back, guys. We're now going to continue our discussion on polarity when our central element has lone pairs. Now, it sucks when our central element has lone pairs because we have more rules we have to follow. So let's take a look. We're going to say when our central element does have lone pairs, the central element must be connected to the same elements. We're also going to say that the central element must be less electronegative than the surrounding elements. Those two rules stay the same, whether we have lone pairs or we don't. Now, here's the new part. We're going to say use dipole arrows to point to the more electronegative element. These dipole arrows must cancel out. Remember, we talked about dipole arrows a few videos back. For them to cancel out, they have to go in opposite directions. If they go inward, they don't cancel out. They actually make the molecule more polar, make the bonds more polar. We're also going to say that we also have dipole arrows for lone pairs. We're going to say dipole arrows extend away from lone pairs. These lone pair dipole arrows must also cancel out. And we need to make a distinction here. We have two types of dipole arrows. We have dipole arrows between elements, and we have dipole arrows between lone pairs. They cannot cancel each other out. Lone pair dipole arrows must cancel out lone pair dipole arrows. Element dipole arrows must cancel out element dipole arrows. Before I let you do this one, let's look at an example together. So let's say we have to draw NH3. NH3 is nitrogen in the center, and we have the hydrogens connected to it. See, our central element has lone pairs, so we use the rules. The central element must be connected to the same elements, which it is, but it breaks rule 2b. The central element is more electronegative. Since it breaks rule 2b, this is automatically polar. So you would say that this compound here is automatically polar. Now let's take a look at another example. Here we're going to say, let's see, we have SN, or actually we'll have O, F2. OF2 would look like this. Now, first rule, we're going to say central element must be connected to the same elements all the way around, which it is. Central element must be less electronegative than the surrounding elements, which it is. Now we have to use dipole arrows for parts C and D. So we're going to say use dipole arrows to point to the more electronegative element. So the way we do this is we look at the oxygen. So here's our oxygen. We're looking between this oxygen here and this fluorine here. We're going to draw a dipole arrow between the two. Whoever is more electronegative between the two, we point the dipole arrow towards them. Fluorine is more electronegative, so we point a dipole arrow towards it. Now we're going to look again at the oxygen and the other fluorine. Again, the dipole arrow will point towards the more electronegative element, that fluorine. Now, we're going to say that these two dipole arrows, element dipole arrows, are pointing in opposite directions. So they're going to cancel each other out. So part C is followed as well. Now we have to go to part D. For part D, lone pairs also have their own dipoles. So we're going to have a dipole arrow extending away from this lone pair and away from this lone pair. We're going to say that both those dipole arrows are pointing in opposite directions, away from each other. Because they're pointing away from each other, they're going to cancel each other out. So part D is also followed. So using part A, B, C, and D, we see that we follow every single rule. Therefore, we'll say that this is nonpolar. That's the steps that you have to take when answering these types of questions. And I want you guys to take the same approach when you draw xenon tetrafluoride. Draw it out first, see if it has lone pairs, use the rules from A to D to see what the correct answer would be. Once you do that, click on the explanation button and see what we do to figure out if it's polar or nonpolar.